everybody? Let's stand and sing together. Right. This is a call and response. I'm going to sing a line, and you're going to sing it right back to me. And there's a little bit that's printed in the bulletin. We'll sing those words first, but don't be surprised if there's a curveball in later verses. Here we go.
Come, let us worship God.
Call to worship. O loving one, in the silence make yourself known to us.
You are compassionate and upright. Therefore, O beloved, we lift up our souls to you.
Show us your ways and teach us your paths. We know your ways are loving and sure.
Guide us in your truth, for you are our beloved.
Give us soft and humble hearts so we can follow you.
Teach us to defend the weak and the poor.
Guide us as we uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed.
Our hope is in you all day long. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame.
Arise, awaken to the new dawn, come into the light.
May we help unfold your plan of the earth. Our hope is in you all day long.
Thank you. who are helping in our story to be prepared. Okay. Well, my first question is, have you ever heard of a game show called The Family Feud?
No.
Have you ever seen that? Okay. Do you know what a feud is?
No.
A feud is a big fight. So, have you ever heard of the Hatfields and McCoys?
No.
Okay, there are these two families in the mountains of West Virginia, who had a big fight. And they passed the fight on from father to son, from mother to daughter, from grandfather to grandson, from grandmother to granddaughter, so that for years they were fighting. And it got to be, well, why are we fighting? Well, because he's a Hatfield. Well, why are we fighting her? Because she's a McCoy. And they were fighting each other just because they were different and they had different names. So today's story, Jesus' story, is similar to that because the Samaritans and the Jews were fighting like that because they were just different. Well, why are we fighting them? Because they're the Samaritans. And sometimes they wouldn't even say that name, they would just spit. And the Samaritans was, well, we're just fighting them because they're the Jews and we don't like them. So they had this fight. So that's important to know because this story is called The Good Samaritan. And it's a story that Jesus told. So once upon a time, there was a traveler, a Jewish man, who was walking down and the road. And he came right through this terrible, dangerous place where some people jumped out at him. Anybody want to jump out right now? Yeah? Yeah. Yeah, hold on.
Boom.
Are you ready?
What? And they took all his stuff and ran away.
Oh, you're going to give me your...
Oh! Rift Savers! So, and they left him there half dead. Okay, and then some people came by. There was a preacher who was walking by. And, looked around, saw some things.
Yeah.
And our victim here was looking for help, but the preacher just sort of, was busy, had meetings to go to, and saw somebody she knew. Mm. Oh, look, it was the music leader at church. Oh, and they had this great reunion. And they realized they were going to come back the other way. They had to talk and chat and catch up a little bit. And, compare notes. And then they walked by and they took note. And our victim asked for help again, appealed. But maybe they thought they needed to take a selfie before they left. Yeah. Maybe they thought they could take a picture of him. I don't even know. No, they could take a picture of themselves, yeah. Yeah. And they went away. And they left him there. And then finally there was a Samaritan who came by. And the Samaritan found his things.
Oh.
Including the breath savers. It should be in there somewhere. And she saw him. It's okay, we'll find him. And she had compassion on him. And she lifted him up and she took him to the hospital and she paid his copay and she left some extra money for whatever test they needed. He was in bad shape, but she returned his goods. And she said, I'm going to come back and check on you, so don't you worry about a thing. And they're going to take care of you here. And she left him in good hands and she went on her way. And she did come back to check on him and make sure that he made his way to where he was going. Yeah, she's checked out. And see, that's what compassion looks like. And so that's the story of the Good Samaritan. And it's reminding us that Jesus calls us to have compassion on people who are different. And if we have a grudge or something, kind of an odd feeling or an ill feeling, ill will towards somebody who's done us wrong, it's important to go a little deeper and find compassion. So if they are in need, if they are reaching their hands out, we can take their hand and help. So here is our prayer for today. Dear God, thank you for Jesus and the stories he teaches us to have compassion, to take care of each other, friends and strangers, people like us and people different from us, and help us do it with kindness and love. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious and loving God, thank you for providing the space and the care to be with each other and to be with you as we walk through the difficult days and those that hold lots and lots of joy. Amen.
Amen.
We have seen the drama of the Good Samaritan, and I'll be reading the passage from which this drama is taken. From Luke 10. One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him the question, "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus replied, "What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?" The man answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "Right," Jesus told him, "do this and you will live." The man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying down, but he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn, where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, "Take care of this man. If this bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I come." Now, which of the 3 would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, "The one who showed him mercy." Then Jesus said, "Yes, now go and do the same."
Grateful to be with you all again today. I wonder if you would pray with me as we enter into this time. Creative God, we are grateful for the ways that you invite us. In the midst of questions and answers, in the in-between times, in the moments of uncertainty, for the ways that you reach into our lives and nudge us towards transformation. I ask that my words would not get in your way as you move this congregation and these people towards love. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We were loading up the white van in Houston, Texas, and moving into a choir tour. Now, I was in the white van. I was one of the drivers with another adult. About 9 students, high school kids, were with us, and in a giant bus of about 30 other students were in front of us. And my only job, 2 weeks into my internship at Memorial Drive Presbyterian Church, was to follow the bus. That's all I had to do. And entertain 9 kids for a road trip from Houston to Boulder, Colorado, where we would be performing at the church that was previously served by the choir director. So this was his homecoming. So we stopped in place to place, eventually in Ghost Ranch up in north in New Mexico. And we were heading out of New Mexico after several days on the road, and went into Alamosa, Colorado, which is in the southern part there. And the big bus moved into lunch. And I thought, well, we're going to beat all 30 of those kids, and we're going to go to a different place for lunch. And so I broke rule number 1. And we went to A&W Root Beer, and we got some root beers, and we were hanging out and playing. And I guess our 9 people took longer than the 30 people. And they came by in the bus and said, "Hey, follow us, catch us in the mountains." And I thought, no problem. I was a little bit nervous. Oh, well, okay. We paid our bill and then jumped in the van and started heading towards the mountains. Alamosa is in a valley. And a valley is between 2 sets of mountains. Which I was from Houston, Texas, and didn't like think all the way through. So I was chasing them into the mountains, ready to catch up to them, moving up these windy roads with the white van, playing sweet, amazing music as we went up, like Bohemian Rhapsody and other kinds of rock songs that we played as a youth group. And there was a road construction site slowing us down. We kept meandering in. There was snow on the ground. Many of these kids hadn't seen snow, so we got pulled over. I thought, we'll catch the bus eventually. They were throwing snowballs. Things were happening. People were excited. I was thinking, it's been a couple of hours. We haven't caught this bus yet. We pulled into a gas station, and we asked, where are we and how far are we from Boulder, Colorado? The concert's in about 3 hours. And they said, well, you're about 6 hours away. You're in Durango, and Boulder's about 6 hours from here. I'm not great at math, but I was doing the math, and I realized I was in big trouble 2 weeks into this, and I began to panic. The other adult was panicking. The students started to realize what was happening. They don't know what they're doing. That was the first thing they thought. I realized I had all of the music for the choir performance in the van. This is pre-cell phone. We had a cello in the very back and a couple of soloists. This was going to be a night to remember at the church that the choir director had served before. And so I sat in the van. We had just gassed up, and I was trying to figure out how we could make up 3 hours of time in the mountains, really worried and devastated in the midst of this uncertainty between here and there. Now, this uncertainty between here and there is something that I've been feeling, that queasy feeling, over the past few months and maybe even couple of years. Maybe times 10, maybe 10 times 10. Now, I've got some personal changes, transitions, some uncertainties that are happening in my life with a couple of students about to move out of our house for at least a semester and maybe longer. I've had a new job shift, and so these little uncertainties have been in my life. And as a 6 on the Enneagram, and if you don't know Enneagram stuff, a 6 on the Enneagram means that I like to worry. I'm good at anticipating the future and being loyal to the past, and fear is my hang-up. So I worry a little bit. But I can't be the only one that has a healthy sense of wariness about the future these days. I don't think it's just 6s, right? Mm-hmm. Now, there are personal and family seasons of all kinds these days. People are moving into a bit of uncertainty in all kinds of ways, moving from high school into work or college, shifting from school to another school, going to a camp, going from a committed relationship to singlehood, or from singlehood to a committed relationship. Some of us are retiring or experiencing new work. These little transitions are important, and they are unsettling. Maybe some of us have come to grips with the loss of a loved one, the uncertainty that comes with that grief. Or we're facing a procedure or have heard news of a diagnosis, and these uncertainties impact us in big ways. Now, you've already heard it expressed a couple of different times this evening that Circle of Mercy is in the midst of transition. Like so many other congregations, exhausted from a couple of years of indoor, outdoor, masked, vaccinated, zoomed, rainy, sunny, windy, paved, gardened, shot glass, communioned worship, people seem a little tired of the uncertainty. And as beautiful as it has been, Circle has been in transition as we've celebrated Nancy's leadership and retirement and the amazing leadership from lay leaders and Missy and Kim, and now the fruits of the pastoral search team. Another round of applause is appropriate for this. As beautiful as these uncertainties have been, they're still uncertain. And beyond our own experiences and our congregational experience, there are these systemic movements that are happening that are seismic. Uncertainty about the ability to make the best choice for healthcare around COVID, mental health, the availability and economics of it, around pregnancy. Uncertainty about the safety of gathering at parades, at schools, grocery stores, rallies, synagogues, mosques, or churches. The uncertainty of the truth, when lies are told, they're shared, they're reposted, retweeted without regard to morality or consequence. Uncertainty about upcoming elections, or how much pressure our democracy can hold. And I think about this a lot, and maybe some of you do as well, but the uncertainty about our climate. When records are being broken over and over again regarding heat and floods, drought, storm, and fire. There's uncertainty regarding racism that has become more clear and more brazen in North America. And oftentimes, these uncertainties are commingling, just compounding suffering. Marine biologist and climate solutions advocate Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson sums it up well, connecting climate and race. She quotes Toni Morrison saying, "The very serious function of racism is distraction. It keeps you from doing your work. It keeps you explaining over and over again your reason for being." As a marine biologist and policy nerd, she says, building community around climate solutions is my life's work. But I'm also a Black person in the United States of America. I work on one existential crisis, but these days I can't concentrate on one because of another. The world of the United States was created with people that look like me in mind. I recognize that I stand in the midst of a legacy of generations of policies, economic decisions, straight up theft and enslavement, theologies and philosophies, propaganda that has made the way for more stability and gain for straight white males. I have been complicit in the uncertainty of the lives of people and creatures living today. Whether it's climate or racism or patriarchy or the economic systems that I live and swim in daily. And this is part of my work as I face personal and systemic uncertainty and how I might address the grief, the shame, with courage and truth. Now, grief and shame is a part of this uncertainty. Frances Weller, author, describes a way of relating to grief in his book, The Wild Edge of Sorrow. He describes an apprenticeship with grief. And with my climate work, we've been working around climate grief and ecological grief and exploring different elements of grief. He describes this apprenticeship, like a lifelong relationship that allows for learning, holding and accompanying sorrow as a way of opening our hearts to be softer, to love in greater ways. And I wonder, as I've been considering this passage, if we might be in a time when we might explore an apprenticeship with uncertainty. It is such a part of our lives now. In the Gospel of Luke, the disciples and the hearers of Jesus in the first century of Roman-occupied Israel must have experienced some uncertainty. Now, the writer in Luke shared that Jesus had turned his face towards Jerusalem, was growing in popularity and unpopularity, was teaching, challenging systems, and healing people. You've heard it twice already that the lawyer in the story stood up to test Jesus. And we know there are all sorts of layers of complexity of why the lawyer was talking to Jesus at all. He asked about how to gain eternal life. And that's a pretty good question. I like that question. Even if the lawyer knew the answer that included echoes from the Jewish Shema and the Hebrew scriptures of Deuteronomy, love God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and echoed the 19th chapter of the Old Testament book of Leviticus, love your neighbor as yourself, the lawyer here was looking for a little clarity, a little certainty about life eternal. What do I need to do to get in? Can you cliff notes it for me a little bit? Give me the answer. Jesus responded to the lawyer after he said the Shema and the love your neighbor as yourself, nice work. Now you know about eternal life. Go and do it. Simple. The lawyer wasn't quite satisfied. You said, love your neighbor as yourself, but the lawyer says, who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Who do I need to love? Can you Cliff's notes it for me a little? Can you give me a little bit more certainty? Who do I need to love? Where are they located? How are they identified? What do they look like? What color of hat are they wearing? What Twitter feed do they follow? Are they Fox people or CNN people? Who are my neighbors? Left or right? Blue or red? TikTok, Snapchat, Insta? Help me narrow it down. How do they eat? Pray. Love. Little Elizabeth Pearl put there for you. The lawyer wanted to know who was in and therefore who was out. He wanted certainty and clarity, and so Jesus told this story that you've heard twice of the good neighbor. The good neighbor who was traveling in uncertain times between places, between Jerusalem and Jericho. We could not tell which of the three, priest, Levite, or Samaritan, especially in those days, you wouldn't know who was going to be the good one, who was the neighbor by their identity itself. We could only tell which was the good neighbor by the actions that they did. One of the people in the story saw a person who had been robbed and beaten, and he responded. I'm going to read this passage. This is the New Revised Standard Version. If you would just hold up a finger if you're comfortable every time I suggest something that this person either thought or did, some reaction that the Samaritan had in this story. The good neighbor, the Samaritan, came near him. And when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, poured oil and wine on them. He put him on his own animal. And I imagine it wouldn't it be funny if it was like a really large dog, or I mean, I know it was probably a horse or a burro, but some other animals, fun to imagine. Brought him into an inn, took care of him, took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, said, take care of him. When I come back, I will repay you whatever you spend. The lawyer asked for certainty about who he should love. Who is my neighbor? Jesus never answered that question. Instead, Jesus responded with another question. Which of the three, priest, Levite, or Samaritan, was a neighbor to the robbed man? Do you remember what he said? The one who showed him mercy or compassion. And Jesus said, okay, you know the answer. Go and do it. In the midst of uncertainty, God's mercy is revealed. Now, the Samaritan had some resources, maybe some time, was able to adapt, had some relationships, some skills, some tools, even an animal, like a large dog, to provide mercy. In 12 or 13 ways, I don't know how many y'all counted, about 12 or 13 ways, the Samaritan was stirred and acted on behalf of compassion. All of these tools available to the Samaritan to do mercy. We're invited not to just look for neighbors. With God's help, we are becoming neighbors. We are helping each other become neighbors, expressing mercy in the midst of such uncertainty. Neighbors are not determined by proximity. This whole story took place between towns, between cities, between times on the way to someplace else. Now, this Colorado trip, I was between Durango and Boulder, sitting in this gas station, devastated. I might lose my job. I was going to lose the respect of all the people, these 9 kids that I just made friends with, their parents, all of this uncertainty. And 2 students came out from the gas station as I was sitting there reckoning with this realization. And one had a bag of Red Vines, this candy, and another one had a Gatorade. And they had bought me snacks and said, we love you, it'll be okay, here's some snacks for the road, I know you're gonna need it. Showing me a little bit of mercy in the midst of the uncertainty. Now the rest of the story is we didn't make it. I'll just like get to that. That's not part of the sermon, but we didn't make it. I didn't get fired. Mercy was shown in a lot of other ways throughout that trip. And I was very grateful, even while being heartbroken for the students and for myself. I wonder, in the midst of this uncertain time, how has God revealed love or mercy to you? It's bad. And yet, I imagine you can think of a time or two. How are you becoming a neighbor right now in this in-between time? Can you recognize the ways you might respond in an unpredictable opportunity for grace? Or you might be gathering some of those 12 or 13 tools, softening your heart, having a little bit extra for someone else, getting a nice large dog to help someone along the way. This is not only about looking outward, it's also about having mercy for ourselves. In the midst of this uncertainty, it's a scary time. How are you finding mercy and grace for yourself when we're unable to be the Good Samaritan every time? Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson has an idea about some good neighbor tools for uncertain times, and she works specifically around climate, but this works for other things as well. And she's imagining a Venn diagram with one circle being what brings you joy. You'll recognize some of this. What sources of satisfaction and delight, the things that bring you life in the world. Another circle is what are you good at? What are the relationships you have? What are the skills that you have? What are you good at? And the third is what needs doing in the world? What justice or climate action needs doing? And in the heart of those three circles is where you might be invited to act in the world. Between what brings you joy, what are you good at, what resources do you have, and what needs doing, this go and do likewise circle. This congregation, more than so many others, empowers each other to become neighbors. Yes. Not in the programs every week in, week out, but in our Monday through Saturday lives. Becoming neighbors in a time of uncertainty. Our God, it's tough to see grace all the time in the midst of what we're experiencing. And yet, we are tasting red vines. We're sipping Gatorade. And we know that somehow God is present with us in this in-between. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Spirit of Jesus, by love, by love.
Are God's gifts of love
for the beloved people of God.
You're invited to take your elements if you brought some from home, and we also will bring elements around if you need them.
In between times, these uncertain times, may the God of grace walk with you in these times. May the Spirit of compassion accompany you in these times. May the Christ of our hearts help you become a neighbor as you go. Amen.
Amen. Amen.